Recently, the United Kingdom took a strong stance to disallow a 19-year-old pregnant mother from returning to the country after she left to marry an IS fighter. Well, that has been a trend the world over, as several young people travel to areas where ISIS is established, but they do return. That's the focus of our crossover to Germany today, because the country is said to be facing increased threats of terrorism following the return of Islamic State fighters to Europe. So how should countries deal with returnees from the ISIS? Thomas Sparrow is political and security correspondent with our partners DW, and he joins me with some analysis, hopefully lessons for Ghana as well. Now, Thomas, it's good to have you this afternoon. Well, is it established how these people make the journey to join a group that is clearly marked out as a terrorist group?
Gifty, it's a pleasure to be back with you on the program and to discuss this issue, which is important not only here in Germany, but is important internationally as well. In fact, I was reading a report which states that around 40,000 international citizens from 80 countries, among them African countries as well, are thought to have joined the so-called Islamic State in Syria and Iraq between 2013 and 2018. So we're talking here about a big international challenge in particular, now that we're also hearing reports about the end of the Islamic State in Syria and Iraq and the possible return of many of those fighters who left their countries of origin in the first place. When you ask about the motives, in other words, why so many people left their countries of origin to join the so-called Islamic State, there have been plenty of studies on this issue. Many of those studies point to the fact that it could be ideological reasons, in other words, that the person leaving a specific country might have sympathies when it comes to the ideological interest of the so-called Islamic State, as well as problems in that person's integration or assimilation, in particular, to Western European countries. In other words, the person does not necessarily feel he or she belongs to his country of origin and then decides to make the step to go and join one of these groups.
Right.
The problem obviously now is what to do when they decide to come back.
And speaking of what to do when they decide to come back, how are European countries able to really identify such young people in the event that they decide to return to their countries? How is that done?
Gifty, you're pointing to the absolute, maybe the most important question here. Germany and, by the way, other European countries have been debating for a long time now what to do with these returnees, how to treat them. And one of the key questions, at least here in Germany, has been how to identify them, how to make sure that when they come back, they are actually the people they say they are. So Germany, for example, has indicated that it is willing to bring back some of its citizens who have fought in Syria or Iraq, for example, but they're only willing to do so if they can identify them clearly in the first place, and if they can also make sure by doing different investigations that they do not pose a serious or a concrete threat to Germany or to Europe. That is, as you can imagine, a very difficult situation. It is a very big challenge in order to identify these people and identify their possible risks, but at least that's something that German authorities are trying to do. It is also something that they have been discussing with other European countries, because again, other European countries are also facing similar challenges in order to bring these people back. There is a big political but also a big legal debate as to how they can bring them back, to what extent they can be put on trial here, where they should be put in rehabilitation programs, if such. And I also want to mention another aspect, because we're not only talking about men here, we're also talking about women and children who also were there in Syria and Iraq, and authorities are obviously trying to understand what they can do exactly with women and children when they come back as well.
Regarding revelations, and it's very interesting that you mentioned the bit about the women and children, because we've seen recently what happened in the United Kingdom. But regarding the revelations by the Domestic Intelligence Agency in Germany, where you are, that threats, there are threats of terrorism, and that it is increasing due to the return of such people. How is the country dealing with this situation? Are they constantly under surveillance? What's really happening?
In particular, what the head of the Domestic Intelligence Agency mentioned is that Germans should not underestimate the threat posed by the so-called Islamic State, even when there are reports that the so-called Islamic State might be nearing its end. He's the head of the Domestic Intelligence Agency was stating, for example, that some of those threats can come from what he described as a cyber virtual caliphate. In other words, using online resources, for example, to attract collaborators in different parts of the world, stating specifically the fact that the ideology is still around, in other words, and mentioning the fact about those returnees and discussing specifically what risk, if any, they pose. So obviously they are discussing not only politically what to do with these returnees, but what type of risks they pose. And obviously one of the risks they pose, if they were radicalized in Syria or Iraq, or if they took part in military operations, is the possibility that once they return back, they could also try those sort of attacks here in Germany or in other parts of Europe. And that's why, obviously, there is a lot of surveillance, but also there is a lot of debate as to what exactly they can do under legal or political frameworks, for example, to monitor conversations, for example, on social media platforms, monitor these people. It is said that it is very difficult to monitor these people 24/7, that you will need various people to only monitor constantly one of these possible attackers, if you will, or at least the returnees. So it is a very big challenge for German security authorities when it comes to monitoring them, monitoring their communications, monitoring their families as well, and determining as clearly as possible what kind of risk they pose, and based on that, what should be done with them.
Well, it's interesting because here in Ghana, for example, the last time we had a Ghanaian had joined the ISIS was way back, I think somewhere in 2015 or so. And what we heard of him was that he had died. But I mean, you certainly need a very sophisticated system to be able to track these people if they decide to return, like the case you're dealing with. But are there any lessons for African countries given the threat of terrorism, especially in the West African sub-region now?
I would agree with you, Gifty, that this is a very sophisticated challenge. And I would add, and perhaps that's something that not only Africans can learn, but Europeans as well, the understanding that this is above all an international challenge. Yes, we might be talking about what Germany in particular is doing to deal with its returnees, but this is something that goes well beyond Germany, and it also goes well beyond Europe. I mentioned at the beginning of our cross today the fact that there have been around 40,000 international citizens from 80 countries. And yes, we're talking most of them from North Africa or Middle East, but we're talking from other countries as well, as far as New Zealand or Australia, or you mentioned the case from Ghana. That report mentioned, for example, that there have been 244 people from sub-Saharan Africa joining the so-called Islamic State. So if you ask me about a lesson, I would say that the lesson for everyone, not only for Africa, is to try and understand this is an international phenomenon that has to be dealt as well internationally. So in other words, a lot of exchange between countries, between security forces, between politicians, in order to deal with this, even when we're hearing those reports that the so-called Islamic State is nearing its end.
Well, Thomas, very interesting discussion there. This certainly is a very complicated matter, but hopefully the world will be able to identify a way to deal with it going forward. Thank you very much, Thomas, for coming through with that information. Thomas Sparrow is political and security correspondent with our partners DW there, coming through for us with some information and analysis on this growing terrorist threat, especially with the fact that people who had left their countries to fight alongside the IS are beginning to return to their original countries. This is still The Pulse with me, Gifty, and our peer.